Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our graduation ceremony at Newcastle this morning. I'd just like to take a few moments before the ceremony starts, which will be in about 5 minutes, to just tell you a little bit about what to expect during the ceremony today. There is some audience participation, but it's mainly standing up, sitting down and clapping, so I think you can all cope with that. The ceremony will last about 45 to 50 minutes, and it will start with the entrance of the academic procession from the back of the hall. The procession will be preceded by a Northumbria piper, and they'll process up this central aisle, and they'll then take their seats on the dais. I'll be asking you to stand just before they enter the hall, and somebody will give you a signal to sit when they sit as well. There'll then be a short welcome speech by our Chancellor, Imriat Dakas, today, and that will be a short welcome speech, and after that it will be the turn of our graduates. So our graduates will be asked to stand up, and they'll be asked to process to the front of the hall by a number of our marshals by the side of the hall. They'll move behind where I'm standing now. This will be where the reader is reading out the names, and their hoods will be put on by the side of me here. So there'll be a hooder on the stage who will take the hoods off our graduates, will hood them, and then when the name is read out, walk across the stage, nod to the Chancellor, and then return to your seat down the central aisle there. This is a celebration, but it's also a formal event, so no selfies or recordings when you're on the stage, please. And while you're remembering all of that, don't forget to smile for the official photography. Guests, this is very much a celebration, especially after the last few years, so please do applaud each and every one of our graduates here today to celebrate their success. After the graduates have all received their degrees, we're then going to award an honorary degree. So there'll be an additional citation and speech for that. And then after that, one of our graduates today will be giving a speech on behalf of our graduates. The ceremony will then be closed. At the end of the ceremony, you'll be asked to stand again while the procession leaves the hall by the central aisle here and departs from the back. I'll then get you to sit down once they've left the hall, and what we'll do first is get the graduates to leave the hall from the door behind me. They're then going to have an informal photo in the courtyard, so we'll ask the guests to just remain in your seats while that happens. We'll have a piper, so you'll be entertained, and then I'll let you know when you can go out and join your family, friends, relatives outside. After that, you're all invited to a reception, and the details for that will be on the tickets that you have today. So some final things. Graduates, could you just check one final time that you're sitting in the correct seat and therefore the correct order? Please could everybody check that your mobile phones are switched to silent to avoid any awkward moments in the ceremony. We did have one in the last ceremony, so please do check. In the event, we're not expecting any fire alarms or evacuations. If one does happen, just please remain calm. We'll tell you what to do. And you are very welcome to take photographs during the ceremony. We would just ask that you show consideration for the other guests around you. So today, as I said at the beginning, is very much a celebration of all the achievements, both for our graduates and for everybody who supported them through their degrees. So we do hope you enjoy the ceremony. Thank you.
I hereby declare open this congregation, which is held for the conferment of university awards. Good morning. Good morning and welcome to all of you. I'm Imtiaz Dharkar and I'm proud to be Chancellor of this great university. I became Chancellor just 2 days ago, so this is all new to me. As you come up here later onto the stage, graduates, what I really will want to do is shake your hands. Actually, what I want to do is hug you. But as I'm not able to do that, I can only do it with words. I look out at you and think of all the praise I could shower on you, the good things I want to say about you. You deserve praise, and I don't want you to feel embarrassed by it. I want you to feel proud. I want you to glow with pride, because this is the day for that. Pride in yourselves and in your university, because we're here in this amazing hall where Dr. Martin Luther King stood. And we know that this university still upholds the values of social justice and humanity that he stood for. That this university's Students' Union stepped up to help refugees with online teaching and support during the COVID-19 lockdown. That this university is officially recognized as a university of sanctuary for its ongoing support of refugees and asylum seekers. That this university has always stood up for the excluded and for the ignored. My parents were Lahori in Glasgow, and I was Glaswegian in a Punjabi household. Outside the front door was no man's land. My mother learned a new language just to survive, but she also mastered the art of wearing killer stiletto heels like some of you here. My parents wanted the best education for me, and I suspect it was just so that they could say, my daughter is a doctor, and she has won a Nobel Prize, and she can make a banquet with one small aubergine. They had the strange idea that I could have this great education, but never use it to question the rules. I answered back on a page by writing poems they never saw. I didn't want to be better than anyone else. I just wanted to be better than myself. And that's what you've done. You've been better. You've been incredible, graduating class of 2022. You'll go down in history as graduates who've succeeded against all the odds, as the graduates whose university studies and experience was rudely interrupted by a global pandemic, as the graduates who've completed your degrees in the face of challenges the likes of which none of us have experienced in our lifetimes. I think that deserves acknowledgement. So I would like to invite everyone, my colleagues, graduates, and guests, to stand now and give yourselves and each other a really big round of applause. That really shows how you feel about the people who are here today. That was a great bit of applause. Day after day, we're reminded of why culture and the arts are more vital than ever. Look at what's happening in the world, and you see why we need people who are digitally, visually, and media literate. People like you, who understand the importance of diverse cultures and heritages, of contributing to the pressing debates at home and internationally, of engaging audiences, and of storytelling with rigor, respect, and care. You can respond across all media, in spaces on site and online, with an awareness where theory, practice, and politics intersect. The research and student work in architecture, planning, and landscape engages with some of the most fraught problems facing our cities and our societies. The world's population reached a tipping point in 2008, when its greater proportion shifted from living in rural areas to living in cities. And as this shift gathers pace, we see it all around us. It's vital for societies to design environments that are better imagined, planned, modeled, drawn, constructed, inhabited, and conserved, to understand how they create communities, how we can build cultures, ideologies, save ourselves from inequalities. And at the same time, it means keeping a closer eye on how we allocate, consume, and generate resources. We are proud of all of you, our students, who've taken such a strong lead in community-based activities, researching issues of local concern. You've already started your journey into professional lives with work towards a sustainable future. So all of you, when you come up on this stage, take your time. Don't rush, especially on those heels. This is your moment. Take it, shine in it, use it. I'll read you a poem which I've written for this university and for you. And I'll end with that. The promise. I look at you and think of all the ways I could say what you have done and sing your praise. I could speak of days when the struggle seemed impossible, the troubles insurmountable, and yet you raised the bar. You have come so far to be honored on this stage. I want to hold you by the hand, keep you here before you turn the page. Your robes are not about power, but empowerment. I wish to say the robes you wear today are more than pomp and ceremony. They are a promise to those who taught you, who supported you, and stood by you. A promise that even if daily demands are tugging at your sleeve, you will follow the thread of knowledge and believe there is always more to learn, discovery at every turn, a meeting point between warp and weft. In a fraying world, there is a weave that holds us close, you to this place, all of us to the space we share with every cell and insect, every living creature. How you treat the weak will be a measure of your strength. How you treat the soil beneath your feet will be remembered by the sky. So step into the radiance of who you are. Take your promise into the world and start afresh. Thank you.
Chancellor Darker, I certify that the candidates to be presented at this congregation have satisfied all the requirements of the university. Chancellor Darker, the head of the School of Architecture, Planning and Landscape, prays leave to present candidates who are qualified to proceed to awards in the School of Architecture, Planning and Landscape.
Dr. Chancellor Dacher, I present to you candidates to be admitted to the award of Bachelor in the School of Architecture, Planning and Landscape.
By the authority of the university, I admit these candidates to the awards for which they are now qualified.
The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Geography and Planning. Christopher Mark Adams. Rachel Ann Brightwell. Alexandra Olivia Colston. Jordan Lucas Datsy. Thomas Martin Devine. Isabel Dixon. George John Fisher. Ryan Solomon Grant. Kieran Vincent Hartley. Annabel Claire Hodgson. Tom Paul Lomas. Eleanor Lausanne Malherb. Harriet Emily McInnes. Ewan David McIntyre. Sarah Elizabeth Rhiannon Palfrey. John Peter Phillips. Grace Robinson. Philippa Alice Jane Smeaton. Henry James Theobald. Joel Sexton Walsh. Thomas Jervis Rath. The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelors of Arts with Honours in Geography and Planning with Placement Year. Jake Andrew John Pedrig J. Patrick Kilvington.
Chancellor Dacher, the head of the School of Arts and Cultures, prays leave to present candidates who are qualified to proceed to awards in the School of Arts and Cultures.
Professor Williamson.
Chancellor Darker, I present to you candidates to be admitted to the awards of Bachelor, Master and Doctor in the School of Arts and Cultures.
By the authority of the University, I admit these candidates to the awards for which they are now qualified.
The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Film and Media. Archie Julian Baker. Lisa Bendel. Anna Margot Williams Fitzgerald. Georgia Forster Adams. Joseph Thomas Hodgetts. Anna Judelzone. Jae Hyun Kim. Nia Boykova Kristeva. Hannah Jane Merrington. Shijia Pan. Christian James Price. Molly Lorna Wilson. Tianhao Xu. The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Film Practices. Olivia Agnes Barnett Brown. Andrew James Angus Brown. Joseph Alfie Critch. Eleanor Alice Rachel Clark. Artemis Constantinou. Xiang Yu Fan. Joseph Daniel Foreman. Molly Emma Fraser. Lauren Philippa Florence Gear. Thomas James Glover Jackson. Xiu Quan Jonathan Mack. Jemima Priest. The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Journalism, Media and Culture. Lucy Amers. Laura Bose. C. Sophie Elizabeth Byrne. Josephine Olivia Canham. Callum John Davies. Ella Louise Davina Graveney. Connor David Greaves. Yasmin Hansen Farid. Arva Karen J. Hartington. Lauren Beth Johnson. Zach Ethan Johnston. Sarah Ann Nichols Lahiri. Talia Perla Lorenz. Gautier Millie. Azucena Inoue Mounier. Amelia Neri. Catherine Elizabeth Partridge. Shu Ting Kwek. Emily Iona Rickaby. Lewis Shotton. Ruby Lee Story Dartford. Ethan Todd. Iona May Todd. Daniel Wales. Chloe Winfield. The following graduate is presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Journalism, Media and Culture with placement here. Charlotte Grace Flint. The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Media, Communication and Cultural Studies. Valeska Cleo Amanta Anwar. Erika Armanino. Xinyu Chai. Shona Chen. Eleanor Mary Clark. Robin Elizabeth Davies. Grace Yasmin Fisher. Christina Gabrowska. Anna Goklowska. Asha Maria Glebowski. Greta Great United. Melissa Ananda Hundruyune. Olivia Hayward. Freya Lucy Hipperson. Sophie Jane Huxley. Hoi Yan Yu. Tyler Alexandra Jackson. Xinlin Ji. Jinyi Ji. Rebecca Kirsten Jones. Alexandra Lauren Kane. Majidul Islam Khan. Henry Kwan. Maya Ann Leaning. Yong Wook Lee. Jing Lee. Eugenia Lowe. Eleanor Dorothy Lodge. Nathan Wingho Lee. Neve Martha Merrigan. Isabella Beatrice Muir. Kate Nichols. Erica Jess Vera Pasco. Shengji Pei. Madeline Jane Piri. Harvey Lewis Renfrit. Virginia Rose Robinson. Yeah. Megan Elizabeth Screen. Rashmi Sundar. Gabriela Tujulkina. Grace Elizabeth Walker. Hannah Elizabeth Walker. Matthew Webster. Mingyu Wei. Ella Rose Winstanley. Yuli Wu. Hoi Ying Yao. Wing Lam Sofina Yu. Chun Zhang. Peitin Zhang. Jai Yi Zhong. Jacobus Daniel Zings. The following graduates are presented for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with honours in Media, Communication and Cultural Studies with placement year. Chloe Valentina Bourdin. Neve McCann. Tra Mi Nguyen. The following graduate is presented for the degree of Master of Arts in International Multimedia Journalism. Abigail Jade Ashley Gardner. The following graduates are presented for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy. For research in an interdisciplinary study of contemporary artistic photo books, Bryony Carlin. For research in online audience practices as constituting a distinctive new mode of cultural meaning making, Jessica Marie Crosby. For research in crisis management, reinvention, and resilience in museums, Philip William Deans. For research in the transformation of museums of modern and contemporary art in Northwest Europe, Alistair Robinson.
Senate has resolved to confer the degree of Doctor of Letters honoris causa upon Circa Lisa Continent.
Chancellor Darker, the past is a foreign country. They do things differently there. The opening lines of L.P. Hartley's novel, The Go-Between, reminds us of the selective and often unreliable nature of memory. But where film and photographic records exist, people and places remain vividly alive, captured for all time through the all-seeing lens of a camera. For more than 50 years, Sirka Liisa Kontinen, whom we are honoring today, has produced iconic and widely recognized images of working class life in the northeast of England. She has done so by engaging deeply and respectfully with communities, celebrating their lives and honoring their culture, whilst creating an important social record of a rapidly vanishing world. Born in 1948 in a small paper mill town in Finland, Sirka is the second oldest in a family of four. Now, according to her husband, Peter, Finland is noted for its gabby women and silent men. I don't know how true that is in Sirka's case, but as the only girl amongst three brothers, I imagine she often had to fight to get her voice heard. She was attracted to photography from an early age, encouraged by her aunt. Aged 17, she saw a documentary film on television and instinctively knew that this is what she wanted to do. As the roles available for women in the film industry were limited to fairly menial tasks like film editing, Sirka determined that this would be her route in. Having secured a commercial loan to fund her studies, she left home in 1968 with a single suitcase and set off for London. It was here at Regent Street Polytechnic that Sirka met like-minded colleagues, most notably Murray Martin. Within a year, Sirka and Murray had left to found the Amber Collective, the group which has been the primary base for her prodigious output. Everything they earned, they pooled. And in the early days, Sirka recollects they lived on very little, around £8 a week each, she told me. Amber was and is passionately committed to celebrating working class culture, which was very poorly represented by the media at that time. They'd always planned to do this from a northern base, and Sirka tells me that she came across Biker almost by chance. Arriving there in 1970, she found a working class suburb very much on its uppers. The tight-knit community was under notice of impending demolition by the local council. Whilst eking out a living from freelance and educational work, Sirka started to photograph the rundown Victorian terraces and the people who lived in them. I roamed around the streets by day and hung about by night, chasing my heartbeats, stumbling in and out of other people's lives, striving to share my excitement through photographs where words would fail me. She found the people of Biker to be open, curious, and proud. They were initially puzzled as to why on earth she would want to live there, but soon took her to their hearts. 7 years later, when she left, she received a postcard which said, "Not only did you immortalize Biker and its many famous characters, you were one of them." Reflecting on Sirka's work, Professor V. Pollock, our Dean of Culture and Creative Arts, observes that she combines powerful compositional skills and artistry, often making the everyday iconic. A critical eye and subtle political power, combined with an almost palpable curiosity about people and place. Sirka's husband Peter concurs. He told me that Sirka is driven by curiosity. She's always asking, "What's going on here? Let's take a look." Yet her approach is never intrusive. She cares about community and relationships. The empathy Sirka brings to her work has led to many lasting friendships. Kitty Luostarian, whom she met at a film festival in Helsinki in 1991, described Sirka to me as instinctive, thoughtful, and wise, someone who has the special ability to see and respect people and engage with them on a profound level. Another friend, Irena Carlton, who met Sirka when she was working on her second book, Biker, told me how they bonded over food. As a newly qualified social worker, Irena was working with refugee women and children, mainly from Africa and the Lebanon, who'd been rehoused in what was then the new Biker. Every Friday, I organized an international women's cooking group. Each woman took turns to share a recipe. We all cooked together, and then we shared the meal with everyone, including people from the local community. Sirka absolutely loved it and came along to cook herself. Irena and Sirka have subsequently cooked all over the world together, India, Bosnia, Croatia, even in the Arabian desert. Sirka's work has been widely recognized and celebrated. In 1980, she became the first photographer since the Cultural Revolution to have her work exhibited by the British Council in China. Her film, The Writing in the Sand, won the Grand Prix at the Melbourne International Film Festival in 1992. And in May 2011, her photography of the northeast of England from 1969 to 2009, together with Amber's related films, became one of the 20 items and collections to join the UK Memory of the World Register. She has been a major influence on other creative practitioners, including Lee Hall, the distinguished playwright and screenwriter, who acknowledges that Sirka's work has been one of the most important influences on my writing from the moment I started. Almost every frame of Billy Elliot was somehow influenced by Step by Step, her book about dancing in industrial Tyneside. What else can I tell you about Sirka? Her talents extend far beyond film and photography. She loves repairing and refashioning clothes rescued from charity shops and creates the most amazing knitted garments without ever following a pattern. Wish I could do that. She is a gifted gardener and relishes her daily dips in the North Sea, whatever the weather. However, while Sirka's ability to do the splits is a source of envy amongst her friends, her navigational skills are not. Or as her good friend Olya wisely advised me, follow her aesthetically, but not literally, on planet Earth. I am indebted to Olya for a lovely reflection with which I'd like to close my citation. She told me, Sirka is a self-confessed wallflower. She eschews the limelight. Her gaze is on the other. Today, Sirka, our gaze is on you, warmly, respectfully, and with the utmost admiration. Chancellor Darker, in recognition of her profound influence on the documentary tradition and her passionate and principled celebration of working class life in the northeast of England, I present to you Sirka Liisa Kontinen for the award of Doctor of Letters, honoris causa.
By the authority of the university, I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Letters, honoris causa.
So much, Jill. I'm truly humbled. So there's something to be said, a lot to be said for getting to my age. You can look back and see that over the years there are certain narratives that are running through your life and through the apparent chaos at times. And I can now see that all through my life, I have been attracted to collectives and communities. And in 1969, I left the film school in London to join the, to become the founder member of the AMBA Film and Photography Collective, an egalitarian workers' collective, where we shared our incomes and ideas, living and working in the communities of the Northeast. And Baika became my first home, and it was the community there that made it a home for me. And my photography found a role amongst the other services of the community, and I stayed until Baika was demolished for its redevelopment. And then it was the community of the mothers and daughters at the Connell Brown Dancing School in North Shields that drew me to begin my step-by-step project. And over its 7 years, I saw the students grow up and with confidence enter the world outside. The Writing in the Sand project is a celebration of the communal nature of the Northeastern beaches, where total strangers can fall into a game with one another, forgetting boundaries of age and class, modesty. We all look good in swimming trunks. And the Coal Ghost project began when a retired Easington miner took me on a walkabout along East Durham's black beaches and interpreted the 100-year legacy of coal mining on the coast. And AMBA has paid homage over the years to the mining communities in a whole series of feature films and photography projects. And during my 6 years of revisiting Baika from 2003, I was introduced to many diverse pockets of communities, and I was particularly drawn to the asylum seeker community, which was new then. Having been one of the old Baika's first foreigners in 1969, and it was the hospitality of the asylum seekers in New Baika that towards me, that reminded me of the generosity of the old Baika community that I received. So I would like to thank all the people that have given me an immeasurably rich half a century living and working in the Northeast. I would like to thank my collective partners at AMBA who have supported me through all these years, especially my husband, Peter Roberts, who has also been my co-creator on all the photo films that accompany these photography projects. I would also like to thank our daughter, Katja Roberts, and son-in-law, Magnus Denison, who work with their, collaboratively with their fellow creatives on their projects at Meerkat Films in Newcastle, and who also keep us up to speed with technology. I would like to thank my friends, Baika-born Olya Bowers, who has gifted me with her stories and insights on both of my Baika projects and who champions all of them. I would like to thank Irena Muchachi-Carlton, who drew me to work alongside her in the Asylum Seeker Support Group, and to cook with the women from African continent who became friends over shared recipes, overcoming the wars back home that had separated them back home. Both Olya and Irena have shown me the beauty of inclusiveness. I thank Newcastle University for bestowing me with this amazing honor. There cannot be a more meaningful recognition of my life and work than the one given to me by my own adopted home city. So, Thank you. And one more thing. For the graduates, I would like to leave you with one thought, which you may have already gleaned from everything I've said so far. Find yourself a community you feel you want to fully give yourself to, or start one yourself. Two people already make a collective, which can become far greater than the sum of its parts, and will also enable you to grow and flourish as an individual. So, thank you.
At this point in the ceremony, we would like to draw your attention to the list of graduates who have been awarded academic prizes. The list can be found at the centre of the congregation brochure. Please join me in giving these graduates a warm round of applause. Before the proceedings are brought to a close, I'm delighted to introduce our student orator, Shengji Pei, who graduated with a degree of Bachelor of Arts with Honours in Media, Communication and Cultural Studies. Shengji will address the congregation on behalf of the students we are celebrating here today.
Good afternoon, dear graduates, guests, and esteemed scholars of Newcastle University. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to stand here to give a short summary of our 3 years of undergraduate study. Over the past 3 years, we have experienced the dual challenges of COVID-19 and learning, a very difficult process as the pandemic has caused us much anxiety. Fortunately, these difficulties did not defeat us, and we have managed to graduate. And now we are able to come together in good health and safety to share the joy of graduation. I hope we can all be proud of the unparalleled efforts we have made and the many unexpected obstacles we have overcome over the past 3 years, as this experience has shaped us into a brave group of people. Bravery is a very broad word, and our parents often tell us to be brave. But what exactly is bravery? Is it a character, a psychological trait, or is it a spiritual quality? I think the word bravery is a medal for those who are willing to move forward despite the difficulties ahead. Roman Roland said that there is only one true heroism in the world, and that is to love life after recognizing it for what it is. The truth of life is that in the future, we will face many failures in business, in life, in relationships, and so on. And failure will divide us into two different states. Some people will be crushed by failure, while others will continue to move forward with courage. We need to remember that success in life is only temporary. Failure is the main theme, and no one can stay on the top forever. As you know, we are all surrounded by young people with the same ambition and enthusiasm, just like us. But that is why we struggle, because success is precious. So please, don't be afraid or frustrated, because true maturity is not about always striving for perfection, but about facing your own shortcomings and acknowledging the strengths of others, because that is what life is all about. In the days ahead, we may encounter injustice, but this will make you realize the importance of social equality. We may encounter deception, but this will make us see the value of honesty. We may even encounter betrayal. This will make us see that loyalty is one of the most valuable qualities a person can possess. Our 3 years at Newcastle University should therefore be about more than just gaining knowledge. We should have learned how to get along with others, how to make and keep commitments, and how to deal with the unexpected in our personal lives. We must therefore always remember that the future will not be smooth, but it will certainly be full of surprises and will inspire you to constantly reflect on yourself. It is time to say goodbye, and we may not see each other again. But remember that we are all from Newcastle University, and we will never forget the bravery of Newcastle University medical students who joined the fight against the epidemic when the NHS was short of medical staff. We will never forget the enchanting lights of the River Tyne, and the sky pink evening sun will light the way for us to move forward. We should be proud to be Newcastle University students and do our best to make Newcastle University proud of us. And the most importantly, you should always be grateful to the self that never gives up. Finally, it is my biggest honor to have witnessed each other's success in the first phase of your lives. I hope you guys all take care, and I hope you will always remain enthusiastic and kind, and we will see each other at the top. Thank you.
Will you please stand?
This congregation is now dissolved.
We hope you enjoyed the ceremony. In a moment or two, my colleagues will be asking our graduates to leave the hall by the door behind me. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the ceremony, you'll have an informal photo in the quadrangle outside. And then we'll ask you to go through the arches, and then we'll invite our guests to join you in the student forum before you go on to your reception. While our graduates are leaving the hall, can I just ask our guests to join me in giving them one last round of applause? Thank you.